months, 6 o'clock, we'll make a start. Just be, well, actually, I'll do this as apologies for absence as well, because Jill Wood's stuck in Stratford, she's going to be late. Councillor McLaughlin has given her apologies, and we have Councillor Povall, who's standing in tonight because of the passing of our colleague, my colleague, as well. Councillor Chris Blakely was an inspiration to myself. He was there from day one when I first got involved, many, many years ago. A formidable opponent for many, I'm sure. And if we could just stand with everyone in mind and just have a minute's silence. Item two on the agenda is declaration of interest. Hopefully all members have had sight of tonight's agenda, so with that in mind, has anyone got any declarations they would like to make? I'll take that as a no. Okay, item three is the minutes from the Standards and Constitutional Oversight Committee held on the 26th of November, and also the Standards Panel on the 4th of December 2019. I'm sure you all know what that was. I don't wish to labour the point and go into that too much this evening. If everyone's had a sight of the minutes, do we all agree that they are an accurate account of what happened? Do you agree?
Agreed. Was for this to be adopted on the 16th of March.
say on point four within this report, which is the financial implications, which I know was something that we spoke at length about before we agreed that we were going to the committee system. And it, I've said it before and I'll say it again, it's commendable the work that officers have put in, particularly in house, Phil and Vicky and the rest of the team, in actually bringing it forward in house and not needing a plethora of people from outside, bringing extra skills in, could it be extremely costly. The figures that were quoted were between 70 and 250,000 that could have been the cost to actually implement it, and I think it's going to be, in relation to that, would be negligible compared to those sort of figures that were being bandied about, which is commendable, as I say. So that's something of note. Has anyone else got any other comments? This last week, if anyone else has got any other comments that they'd like to make on the current draft? No? Phil?
I'm sorry, I'm sorry. It's fair to say that REMS has set about this with a degree of determination to go through all that work, and I think officers would like to thank for their support during that period. We're 90% of the way there, subject to the consultation with members. There have been a few sticking points, but with the give and take on behalf of members, I think we've created, or are in the process of creating, a workable constitution which ought to serve us well. But if difficulties and glitches are found or arise, we will have the opportunity over the next 12 months to make minor adjustments that will help members in practice.
Yeah, Phil, I'll just add to that. Again, that was something that was debated quite thoroughly as to how long it may take and was it feasible, was it possible to actually implement and have a working constitution by May. And I think the Director of Law probably agreed with me that when I say, and when Phil says, it's probably 90% there. That is effectively in front of you now, a feasible working constitution, and we are just now sort of ironing out any of the caprices that we're not 100% happy with. So come May, it should be, not even come May, to be honest, come the end of March, it should be ready to be accepted by full council.
Yeah, well, thanks. I mean, as Phil said at the end of his last comments there, the fact that we can make minor adjustments during the year, I think that's going to help and reassure all the people, to be honest with you. Maybe for the Cooke comments as well, how does that work? To do that, there's got to be, obviously, I presume there's got to be agreements between the parties for any changes that happen during the year to the committee. But before you answer that, just a couple of things, wouldn't I? I've still got a number of questions as well, and I'll pass them on, please, Phil, to you from members rather than bring them up here tonight. And thanks for answering them. Also, the fact that we've had the workshops has helped, and more workshops coming up, different types of workshops in some respects, internal and external. I think that's helped the process. And we've had our own, the LGA Labour peer coming in last week, really helped us and reassured our members as well. But just to finish, just if I may,
is the fact that whilst the constitution had been deemed not fit for purpose, that we were currently working for, and could have been improved massively, and we've taken this opportunity to obviously rewrite it because we were going to have to anyway. There were bits within there that were actually deemed better than the one when we've actually left there. I think that's reasonable to say. So there were some things that we've actually doing right anyway. So if no one else has got anything else, I know Chris will want to propose something.
Hi Chair, thank you very much. It would be appropriate perhaps, although what I propose only involves a motion which contains a few words, namely the committee, and how it's going to sound for everybody, so I'd like to have a look.
Second,
I argue for it. You will talk about the way
I not denying that you did on
the system.
That's a good way to
Chair, following on that previous discussion, are you willing to alter this so that it also says at the end that to take the policy lead for climate emergency currently at 3B1.2F in the draft?
Yes, I think that would be satisfactory.
Okay, well, we'll have a little debate with this. Sherry, would you like to go first?
Can I just ask, does the word transport really encompass highways and infrastructure? Does that mean the same thing as highways and infrastructure? Because I wouldn't think that transport meant the same thing as highways and infrastructure.
Yeah, that is kind of an aside as well. We did go around in circles on that one, and it was debated to death as to what was happening in the end. Is the name of the committee was becoming so unwieldy. We needed a special kind of sign to be able to actually write it anywhere. When it comes to the size, it was nonsense. So it got screened a little bit. But yeah, it is effectively infrastructure. But yeah, I do take your point. Phil?
This was discussed, and I thought about it on how, as someone who hasn't flown since 1990 on principle, and who tries to drive as little as possible, then I often wonder what we'll do. I'll work through this logically. The first issue is that until a few years ago, we had carbon, annual carbon statement on our annual council budget. And that disappeared in 2016. So it was lost sight of, even having committees that dealt with the environment. No work went on in the background, more officers. I agree that each committee, and we have agreed that each committee will have a statement on climate impact, and that refers to all the seven service committees, policy and service committees, so they will know what impact of any decision they take. The issue to me is the real coordination of things. What we discussed last time we talked about it was that each agenda of policy resources, there should be a report from all the relevant parts of the council of what they've done since the last meeting. Because somebody has to keep track of it. My worry is that if climate emergency is with what sounds a good place to put it, but if it's there, where is the oversight of what's going on throughout the council? And that was my worry about leaving it with the service committee.
I'm just going to follow my two points with them now. First of all, with regards to the change from infrastructure to transport, which we did have transport and ended up with infrastructure, as Chevy just highlighted, I think that probably dilutes a little bit what the overall function of the committee is going to be. Certainly, I recall when we started, because certain individuals had obviously suggested that it should have climate emergency within the title. My concern at that point in time was that it would, that one item, that one agenda item, would completely and totally take control of all of that committee. And while it's called the environmental committee, it's much, much more than just climate change, than just carbon emission. The remit of that particular committee is going to be enormous. Then secondly, the argument was then posed that if the oversight falls just to one committee, and which would now be called the Environment and Climate Emergency and Transport Committee, it will be lost within the other committees. And whilst I take Chris's position, I believe it is symbolic, and it may look like a win for a win against climate change. It may look like a win for green issues, but to have oversight purely in one committee, it will be lost on the other five. And then within PNR, if oversight is within PNR, all of the chairs of all of the other committees are very likely, looking at what we've proposed within the current draft constitution, will sit disseminated from PNR and it will cascade down. And I genuinely believe that if we just have one committee, the environment and climate and agency transport committee, I think it would be lost on the committee. So whilst I take your point, Chris, and I can see why you would want the actual words appearing somewhere within the committee structure, I think it will have the opposite effect of what we're trying to achieve. Councillor Hackett.
Thanks a lot. I'm going to disagree with you, obviously, because I did argue this last time. I understand the point you're making. I think we all want to go in the same direction. We want to make sure that climate change and emergency that we passed last year is given the front page that it deserves within this council. And I do feel, I understand what you're saying, but I do think that threat, as it were, is going to be run through all the committees, as Councillor Gilchrist just said, because it's going to be there, isn't it? Just like we used to have done years ago, as I've said many times, Agenda 21, which was an environmental thing we used to have years ago. We now have the impact of climate change on every committee paper. So that's going to be, that threat's going to be there throughout all the committees, I would say. But I do feel, I understand what's been said in the past, that it's going to be, the seriousness of it is, it's going to be reflected in the papers within the PNR committee, understand what you're saying. But I do feel you don't actually see the name, and that's what the public say. The public don't see the name in the second stages. And I do think it's important that we have the name there within it. And as we said before, just to finish, if it's not working,
say is
challenges all around. We're having to deal with it every day. I'm in my own area, I've been writing tomes about sustainability in medicine, and it's really sense, but I just can't see where the emergency comes.
You may have picked up on my very careful wording when I use climate change. Others within our midst who use climate emergency continually and would use climate change and still do. For that reason, there's arguments as to whether it's been sensationalised into the word emergency for focus rather than and whether it's having the correct outcome, should we say. But that, it is an aside, I suppose. Shall
I? It was just to say that is, I don't think it's been used to raise it in sort of to sensationalise. I just don't appreciate that word because I think it is an important issue that is impacting on everybody. It's where that sits, but I don't think it's about sensationalising, it's about the actual reality of everything that we must do. We're living this week alone, the amount of flooding that's going on, storms, changes that's happened in the climate. It can't be ignored, but I do worry about the word emergency over time losing that emphasis. And people think, well, if you haven't dealt with the emergency in year one, year two, year three, you're constantly saying it's an emergency. It kind of eats on itself to say that you're not dealing with it. But that's me personally saying it. I do think the word climate is important.
That's I do think the word emergency is important as well because it is an emergency and we passed an emergency motion last year and we're serious about it. We need to make sure it is on the front page. And in terms of the way we're going, could go to an emergency. You just mentioned a couple of things there, Jill, you know, there's a lot more besides and could be a lot more speaking about the seriousness of the environmental situation with it worldwide, never mind in this country. So I do think it's an emergency. The word eventually being there clarifies and shows the importance we attach to as a council and it sends a signal to the general public as well, which is really important.
On some level, I suppose we digress really, but what we're talking about really now is around fiscal motion is whether we believe as a group. Sorry, I've been calling now because I know wants to speak about it. And Phil as well, I've almost forgot Phil. Whether we believe it's going to be more beneficial or less beneficial to have one committee which is a lower tier than the PNR, which has more control, more strategic oversight for the council operations, whether it's going to be more beneficial or less beneficial to highlight climate change, climate emergency, whatever we will call it. That's something we need to focus minds on, Phil.
Yeah,
I'm Yes, and I'm going to close and then put us to go to a vote, I think. Yes.
Thanks, Chair. I appreciate what the Council Steward said, and also I understand Council Gilchrist put the interview on the PNR taking the lead on things, but surely, you know, with the National Agency in a particular committee with a particular portfolio, in terms of the reference, it would still be the role of the PNR to make sure to hold each committee to account, to ensure that it wants to fulfill its role in every sort of department. So I don't really see a problem of, you know, the Council Agency being not sufficiently given prominence by the fact that the PNR wouldn't be directly leading on it, if you see what I mean.
The terms of reference to go into that committee.
So it's what printed there plus and take the policy of an emergency bracket coming with 3B1 to C2.
Okay, we move on to item 5, which is updates and progress made in respect of the changing government, Steve.
Mr. Chair, thank you very much. It's a very brief report just to inform members of the other work that's going on as part of the changing government arrangements. Four key elements of the report: there's the independent remuneration panel, training of the councils and officers, redesign of my service area, and the committee's proposed or indicative committee cycle for 2020-21. Just a few things to highlight for four members. The independent remuneration panel has commenced their meetings. They've got a meeting with group leaders and deputies tomorrow afternoon. The plan at the moment is to present a members' allowances scheme to the council meeting on the 15th of April for approval alongside, hopefully, the constitution. In terms of training for members, I've supported or been helped by colleagues from the Centre for Public Scrutiny. An initial needs assessment meeting was held on the 5th of February, attended by a number of councillors from around the table as well as group leaders. That's informed of a work programme that's going to be training programme for members on the 11th of March. There's a morning, afternoon and evening session. I can tell members that the responses that we've had from the group office managers are that those training sessions are going to be very well attended. There's a further training session on the 25th of March for chairs, and I'll be liaising with the group office managers to get names of councillors to be attending that. That's at 4 p.m. Obviously, along to meet with senior managers in the, within the council on, it's actually now the 22nd of April, at what we call the CMT meeting, and we're working on a programme for targeted sessions with key report authors who will be writing reports for future community meetings. Finally, attached appendix one is an indicative business programme, a committee programme. It's based on a 6 week recycle for the service based committees, monthly meetings of policy and resources, no changes for planning and licensing. The only thing I would draw members' attention to is due to the bank holiday in May moving to Friday the 8th. We've had to put annual council back again. Normally, you understand meeting on Monday, Tuesday, it's now meeting on the Tuesday, Wednesday. We might have to move the meetings of licensing and planning schedule for Wednesday, Thursday, back to the week after. But like I say, it's an indicative programme at the moment, it's there for comment. Presenting it to council along with the constitution in April. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. I'd just like to place some record my thanks to Steve as well. He's done a thorough job in getting both members and officers ready for this transition. There has been training, there will continue to be training for both of us.